What's going on, y'all? This is Jay Lee Degood, and I am sitting here with a good friend of mine, independent professional wrestler, soon to be radio superstar, hopefully one of these days. I'm praying for him, I'm pulling for him, but go ahead and introduce yourself, my man, to all the viewers out there to check me out, you know what I mean, the whole six of them. No, that's fine. there might be six of them, but anyway, go ahead and tell me who you are.
I mean, you might have six, but I only have like one or two.
That's fine, so we got a total of seven or eight, we're good. we're building an audience.
But for everybody that don't know who I am Marcus Waters. I'm one half of the talented tag team, the Hotlanta Hustlers.
Woo! Oh, shit! Hotlanta in the house!
Shout out to my tag partner.
Yes, this is about wrestling. This is about professional wrestling. That's what this episode is going to be about. That's what I'm talking about. Marcus Waters is in the house.
Shout out to, like I said a while ago, to my tag partner, Muddy Waters.
Muddy, my boy.
And to my manager, KK.
Right on. Well, let me ask you a couple questions. I'll go ahead and do what I do best, and that's just interview. I mean, that's what I did when I was working for 1CW. When I retired, I was behind the stage. I was behind in the locker room. I had the microphone, and I was interviewing the stars of the show. All right, I like interviewing independent professional wrestlers. I started in this business in 2000. You know what I mean? I started wrestling, pushing and getting bookings and stuff at least once a month to start in 2001. And then it just took off in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I said, boom, in 2011, I had to be done with it. You know what I mean? My back's all jacked up. And plus, these cats right here coming along just kicking our old man's asses. You know what I mean? Just, we got to kind of like back out, shake the hand, pass the torch. But I never got a chance to really pass the torch to anybody. The person I did pass the torch to, anyway, I lost. But anyway, so, it was, hey, 10 months reign. You know what I mean? I did hold that DCW Hardcore Championship for 10 straight months. You know, I did beat the legendary, the late, great Axel Rotten, you know what I mean, in a steel cage match.
That's somebody that I wanted to meet, but I never got a chance to.
Brian was awesome, bro.
To be honest with you, as you know, but they probably don't know, I'm starting up the magazine.
Right.
Called Del Marvel Wrestling Digest.
Del Marvel Wrestling Digest, right? That .com or something? It's just,
yeah, you got it.
.com, yo. Yeah. I couldn't find it, Jay!
But the whole reason for Del Marvel Wrestling Digest is basically to highlight professional wrestling on Delmarva, which is Delaware, Maryland, and Virginia, for those people that
all necessary. This is our tri-state.
And once I found out that he was from this area, that's when I was like, yo, I got to reach out to him. And I reached out to him, like, a week or so right before he died and asked him, hey, bro, I'm trying to interview you for my magazine.
Right. He was on a podcast show.
He was doing the Jericho's podcast. Actually.
Yeah, yeah.
He was doing that, and he was in the I have a cousin that works in a nursing home.
Right.
He was in a nursing home in Salisbury, Maryland, and I was talking to my cousin, and my cousin was trying to make everything happen, put everything together, and he came home. I sent him a message on Facebook, and was like, "Hey, dude, I'm trying to interview you for my magazine. I want to." I think it would be pretty interesting.
That would have been a great aspect. I mean, that would have been a great person to have, to do an interview for you, man. And keep pushing, man. Trying to, who's featured in this? When's the magazine coming out first? I mean, when's the first, issue?
The first issue is coming out at the beginning of the year.
Beginning of the year? January 1st, 2nd, or just sometime within that first week or two?
The first week or two of January is coming out.
So we're bugging us. What's that? What's going on, man?
You heard it.
For the man himself.
It's coming out the first week or two of January, depending on how long it takes for them to print it out. And basically, it's an intro to everything wrestling Del Marva. Like, if you're a professional, if you're a promotion and you got a show that's coming up within, like, it's coming out every 3 months, so every quarter.
You're going to do four matches. So you're going to do a match a month, and you're going to spend most of the time working on a radio show.
Right.
So you're going to take an early retirement.
Right? Is that signs of, like, maybe finding some other love and just, like, slowly getting away from the business? Because I do want to talk to you about the business, because I just want to see what you've been taught, what you've been told, and, you know what I mean? And just let me, just, I just want to vibe with you on it, because, like I said, I just got back from L.A. I've only been home a little over 2 weeks. So this is 2 weeks as of today, matter of fact. And, like, it's, you know, you're the first person that I've seen other than Sean Hardy, who I did go see yesterday. Right. I talked to. Everything's okay. Everything's cool.
Yeah, actually.
See, Sean. Sean's all right. You know what I mean? Going to have him here soon.
Actually, I want to say this, too. Shout out to Sean.
Yeah.
Because me and Sean actually had heat for a long time.
Right.
And the reason why me and Sean had heat, he finally, like, cleared that whole thing up and took care of that. So, thank you, Sean.
Yeah. Hey, let me tell you something, man. I mean, I'm not going to speak too much on this guy, but I'm going to tell you what. He was one of the two people that I went and saw. Matter of fact, he was the first one I saw. And them stories that come later on in later episodes. But it's about this man right here tonight. It's about what he's got going on. So the magazine's going to come out in January. What featured workers, wrestlers or, you know, everybody. So everybody knows what a worker is. So, you know, it's not like I just, you know, gave up something. But, you know, who are you going to have? And who are you featuring in as the cover story of the magazine? And what, you know, what is going to be on the front cover?
The cover story for this episode, I mean, for this magazine here is basically the Toys for Tots event that we covered, that we did for
photographs in there from that.
Yeah, photographs and all that for that. We're going to have, you know, of course, the Briscoe brothers.
Yeah, Mark and Jay.
Mark and Jay.
Shout out to Mark and Jay Briscoe. Delaware natives.
Yeah.
Our state buddy, right here.
They were there. Yeah, the Last Warrior, Grey Wolf, your former tag team.
Yeah, my former tag team. Grey Wolf, what's going on, man? I love that dude, man. Listen, well, I remember when Sean said, hey, man, I got a tag team partner for you. You're going to see him soon. And then when I saw him, I was like, yeah, remember you? Like, oh, dude, you going to put him? You see the size of this guy? Oh, my God. Yeah, awesome dude, man. I like him. Can't wait to see him. I can't wait for this to explode, because not only will, you know, you will see him again. I mean, matter of fact, he could be, this could be something as far as the wrestling that we'll talk about right here, which, you know, putting this, you know, out there and letting people see it. Hold on, do I look like I'm taller than you in the thing? A little bit? Like in the picture there?
Okay. Yeah, in the picture, yeah, I do.
All right.
I mean, what you cool?
All right, I'm good now. Shit, I'm down here. I did, my hand was like way up here. You didn't see it. It's crazy. Anyway, don't worry about that. But anyway, so you got a magazine coming out, You got the radio. Tell them about the radio. Let everybody know what's going on with this whole radio situation. I've been checking you out on your live feed, man. I'm like, yo, he's up in the radio. He's got a microphone on here. Four pieces, chunk of yellow wall hanging over there. So he'll spill in the microphone.
All right, as far as the radio, it stems from the magazine.
All right, so it's a push from the magazine, too. Or so maybe the radio is a push from coming out of the magazine. You'll be talking about the radio. Everything in the magazine,
basically,
right?
It's like, okay, I'm putting out the magazine, but for everything that don't make the magazine, that gives me a topic for as far as the radio. Because, like, every week I'm doing, as far as with Blueprint Productions and Real Deal TV, I'm doing Marcus Waters Wednesdays.
Yeah.
Which is on my Facebook Live, which is basically every week, just whatever it is that the fans want to talk about, that's what we're going to talk about.
Have you created a YouTube channel yet for your Marcus Warner Wednesdays?
No, actually, I haven't, because it's
getting ready to get done, buddy. You need that, though. I mean, honestly, we need that. I mean, honestly, listen to me. Be smart, at least shoot twice. Like I was going to ask you, you know, you could have been live right now on top of this bad boy. All your people would see it live. They would see what I was talking about as far as, you know, the camera like that, and you're set up like this. You can knock it off at this radio station. I know you can't
wear these microphones and be right at home. You'd be good to go. Or right. Be hanging. And that's what I'm going to work on. We're going to do it right back here.
We're going to step it up. And that's good. Radio. Talk about the radio. It's a sports channel, right? Is it 105.7? Is that the channel?
It's four different stations within one building.
Now, how did you land this? How did you come about this radio station, man? I mean, this is like, right, fucking great. I mean, it's like, the only wrestler I know in the state of Delaware is in the studio. All right, listen, I got some open mics right here in front of me. I got mics over here behind me. Check it out.
He's turning the fucking camera around. You can see everybody in the joint.
It's the radio.
I'm like, yeah. All right, let me explain to y'all real quick. This is basically how it went down. Before I got into the wrestling business, I was doing radio. All
right.
Before I got into the wrestling business, I went into, it's MTS Broadcasting. That's the name of the company. I went to them and I was like, hey, look, I've never went to school or anything like that, but I DJ. Like, I'm a club DJ and everything else. Like, I want to know what steps will I have to take in order to get into and on radio. So, and like I said, I told them, like, hey, I never went to school or anything like that for that. And basically what they were saying is, like, hey, you got to do this and that and whatever. And I'm like, okay, well, look, instead of me going to school, can I come here and work, do an apprenticeship under y'all?
So that's like an OJT right there. Yeah.
Like, let me come here and take it. Like, I want to do an apprenticeship. Like, I want to prove to you that everything I say I am, I am. You know what I'm saying? Right, so
nobody's doubting you now.
Right.
Hey, I was watching last night. He was like, check it out, Clay.
And I've been there now for like 6-7 years. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
And when I first got there, my first year and a half, I did for free. Every Sunday, I would always go in and do the, you know how like they do the broadcast
before
church services,
right,
and all that.
Right.
Every Sunday, I would go in and I would do that. And then when they would have like the like it would be all of that, and then that's when they seen, okay, well, he's doing a good job with that. Let's see what the like the Baltimore Ravens football games and the Baltimore Orioles baseball games.
So they weren't covering anything like that on that aspect or that level of.
They were doing it. They were doing it, but it's like they would just send me in. And I'm sitting in front of the computer, like pressing buttons, make sure that everything go and do what it's supposed to do. And that's when like I kept going to them and telling them, like, hey, look, I want to do this, that, and whatever. And finally they pretty much were like, okay, cool. We're gonna see what you can do.
Put you in there, let you mess around with everything. You got a sound, man, right? Do you have to sit down yourself and adjust, you know, your sound? You get your mic set the way you want it. Like some people want their mic, like, you know, but this is about all you hear, you know, but these are $50 mics. So you gotta go to the chin with it, you know what I mean? Like, go to the concert. Yo. So what's up, Marcus?
So basically what I did is with me first coming in doing the apprenticeship, I learned how to work the boards.
Nice.
So I know how to adjust the volume for this and push this button and make that work and do that and whatever.
That's a lot of work, man. I mean, these are a lot. I've seen these boards inside these studios, man, for, you know, recording. I've been there, done that, but man, they're as big as this table we're sitting in front of some of.
Right.
What do you have in front of you? Are you working more off of like some type of software, off of a laptop, off of just a couple computers?
We have a computer like over here, and this is the live
board. Right.
Like whatever you push anything over here, that's what's going playing to the audience. You have another computer over here, so basically, if you needed to,
if you're recording the whole episode, it was all done through that system. As far as like your barrier for like your any guests that you have on, notice you got some empty microphones there.
I got a board.
Are they like on the other side?
Yeah, I got like it's basically how this whole table here.
Phone lines?
Yeah. Like, we have this whole table set up. Like, it's the board, two computers,
right,
and then that's where the microphone's facing out to them.
So you got one. You're pretty much the head brother in charge of this setup. How long, much time are they going to give you? Are they going to give you like an hour, 2 hours? Are you on from like 5 to 7 every day? Are you there from 7 to 10? I mean,
that's what
we're trying to do, morning or night.
That's where we at now. We're trying to debate on what aspect, what angle to.
And you don't want to do every day. This is just once a week.
I mean,
are you trying to record for something to just come on once a week, or would you like to come on every night
however they want to do it.
Don't matter. Like, what a weekday. I'm just saying, it's what I'm doing. You know what I mean? I'm putting
Well, I'm putting the playlist together. We've already uploaded tonight's half-hour segment. Episode 2 is on from season 1.
Right.
I'm going to put this in as episode 3 of season 1. Basically, you know, I'm going to playlist it. It's still be under the J.D. Degood Show featuring Marcus Waters. You know, we're doing all that now. But, all right, so the radio, man, that's great. God, man, it's good, man. So you got that lockdown. You're in there. We've been there 6 years. They love the idea. So tell us a little bit about, you know, your audience. What type of people are you drawing in right now? And when you're live, are you also on the radio at that same time?
Yeah.
I noticed you had to cut, you know, for a little bit last night. You know what I mean? You cut, like you paused, so nobody can hear you. For what? It was a run or something that came up. Oh,
I had to cut the mic last night.
He cut the mic.
I had to cut the mic last night because, listen, I have a friend who is a real cool guy, friend of mine. We've been friends for over 20-some years. He got deported. He's not a legal alien. Like, he came in, got his green card and all of that.
Right.
But when you...
Green, too, was green like money.
But he came into the United States and everything was cool. And he got caught up in a legal situation that, mind you, he was found not guilty of the situation.
Right.
But the way how the whole thing with green cards and all that work, if you being the charge that he caught, I mean, it wasn't no sexual charge or anything like that.
Right, right.
It was like a robbery charge.
Right.
He was found
just not... Just a robbery charge.
Yeah, just
a small. That's small shit.
But he was found not guilty on it. But due to the fact that he wasn't originally from here, INS came in and they shipped him back over to Haiti.
Right.
So, since he's been over in Haiti, he's been trying to... He's been trying to get back over or whatever, trying to do his whole thing.
Get his life together.
Yeah, they told him he can't come back for like 10 years. So,
damn.
He asked me, like, man, look, I fell on some hard times.
Right.
Can you send me some money?
Right, right.
I'm like, all right, cool, I got you. So, he kept rushing me. Like, I'm a pretty busy dude.
Right, right, right. Awesome. And he got all that. We'll talk about that. That's another hustler session. It's gonna be a whole half hour. We talk straight gangster this motherfucker. Straight up, hey, man. Break it down. But hey, listen up. But okay, so listen, we don't want to burn out because you know we only got half an hour. Listen, so you took care of this guy. You blessed him, apparently.
Right.
I mean, you looked out for the motherfucker. Right. That's what I'm talking about. Some OG type shit at a young age.
The way how I did him. It's crazy because he kept rushing me, right? So
right.
when he did that, I'm like, okay, I got something for you. You know what, Western Union and all that, when you send money,
right.
You send a secret question.
The secret question. You got to answer. You got to have the answer to that secret question.
So this is why I had to go.
It's flying the car here. It's rib time.
Yeah, it's not a rib. So my rib on him was, the secret question was, who sucks dick?
That was great. And I don't have to bleep nothing out.
And the secret answer was, his name was Bishop. Bishop sucks dick. So what he did.
Damn, who was Bishop Slade? I had to wrestle that dude once.
Nah, I know. But I did that shit to him because, like, you rushing me. So, like, I didn't, the shit
you had it. He didn't have to rush you because you were going to take care of
him. I was going to take care of him.
He wanted you to just stop what you was doing right then and there and take care of Chris.
So I said, okay, I got you. What we going to do? I'm going to send this shit just like that.
What's wrong, man? What's wrong?
I'm going to send this shit just like that. And when you got to go in front of whoever, and I was really hoping that he was either a hot chick or someone that was gay. And it turned out to be somebody gay.
Excuse me, sir, but I need to know what the answer is to this question. What family member in your family sucked dick?
You know, I mean, just in case it was family, right?
And not your mother. Any brothers or sisters and not your sister.
You gotta leave your brother out. You know?
Anyway, so you got this fucking place. That's great, man. Now, listen, I got a question. I got an issue because my people don't want to know. They're going to be like, yo, why didn't you ask him this, man? I told you to ask him this, Holmes. When's your next match? Where's it going to be at? And who are you going to kick the shit out of?
Actually, to be honest with you,
like a mini Mark Henry sitting over here. Anybody? Like a Devon Dunley up in the house. Right? Who do you think think it looks like? You guys just need the comments. That's all. You have to see. You can't call in. I ain't got the number up. Plus, we ain't live. But just leave your comments on who do you think he looks like. And throw the mic down some. I look like Bruce Willis. All right, so where are you going to be at next?
Basically for the next year.
Yeah. I mean, listen. For next year. He's retired.
No.
He's going to get old and tired.
I'm all over the place.
You're very busy, man.
I'm not one of those dudes that just... Like, there's a lot of guys that I run into that they only want to work one company, one state, whatever.
The hell with that. Work them all.
Man, that's the whole... That's my whole mentality.
You got to get out there.
Like this past Sunday, I was in Virginia.
Yeah.
And
Virginia for lovers.
I was in Virginia. And
did you find love in Virginia? Did you mean it? First of all, I don't know, but are you married? You got a wife?
No,
you're single. You're a single man.
I'm not married.
You're a bachelor.
He's not married. He didn't say he's single. He must have a little honey out there that'll watch this. But hey, if he does, hey, you got a good man right here. Anyway, so Virginia, and then where'd you go from there?
I went from Virginia to West Virginia.
What part of West Virginia you go to?
I was
in the hills too, wasn't
it? Yeah, it was.
Sometimes you were on Street 50.
It was on Berkeley Springs.
Oh, God, you are up there. It's like driving and shit. You look down some of them cliffs and edges and you're like, yo, it's like a pow down. You know? Don't roll over this wall.
Hey, listen. Me and Carrie was on the road. We were going there. It the whole drive.
Just rolling.
It's rolling.
Pick up trucks everywhere. Rednecks hanging on at the side of the baseball bats.
Come on back here, nigga. We gonna get you.
Now, hell no. I got a story to tell you about some West Virginia. No lie, my boys are all about it. Me and two of my homeboys took the wrong turn. I'll tell you about that one. We might even go past 30 minutes here. But anyway, so you go to Virginia. Was there any brothers at the wrestling show?
Yo, I...
Don't lie.
No, listen.
Only workers and their family members. Somebody came with them.
It was three workers.
Oh my lord!
Including myself, that was black.
Right, that's it.
And it was
rednecks everywhere.
Rednecks everywhere. One black dude in the whole crowd.
Wow! And he was someone's slave, bro.
He don't know you. You let him know. Your brother, you're free, man. I'd be like, yo, homeboy. I'd have done. You know, I'd have ripped him in the stage. I'd be like, yo, look at all these summer team rednecks in here.
They had him as security.
Let's get the black man. Where's he doing?
You fucking racist redneck bastards. I hope all you motherfuckers choke on a chicken wing.
Yeah,
you like chicken too. Don't fucking lie.
They had him as security, so I felt safe. I mean, I felt safe anywhere I go.
All right, listen. Road trips. What's the farthest that you've been so far in the United States of America? I know you just really jumped. I mean, because you ain't been what? 3-4 years, you pretty much jumped in it?
About 4.5 now.
4.5 now. So, I mean, because I remember training. I got a photograph of you. There you go. Don't make me bust it out. It is on the other Facebook page, Jade Lee Degood. You can go check that out sometimes. There is some good pictures there. But, yeah, so let me ask you a question, because, I've told a lot of people, that me and Sean, We sat down. I remember the day we were like, all right, listen, DCW's done. We got that going on anymore. We're not working with them anymore. We got to do something on our own. So we chilled for a while before we brought something back. We just come up with the 1CW, First State Championship Wrestling. Because when we first come up with the idea in 2002, it was Delaware Valley Championship Wrestling. I really like that DVCW, I was like, yeah, that DVCW, man, that Delaware Valley Championship Wrestling. Yeah, championship. I liked it. And then I was like, then you got Delaware Championship Wrestling. And he was like, yeah. He said, but if you type in Delaware Championship Wrestling on YouTube, some college wrestling shit comes up. It's neat.
Right.
You got to type in the names of these companies now. So we flipped the coin. DCW was. We gave birth to it in February. So what company was the first company that you made your debut with? Was it 1CW?
No, actually, the first company that I've ever performed for, and this is a fun fact.
I'm going to guess it right now. It'll take a wild guess.
What's that?
James's show over there for Ellsworth. Never worked for Ellsworth?
Wow. I've worked for Ellsworth one time.
Wow. James Ellsworth, yeah. Yeah, we know him. I mean, he's been involved in a couple of my matches, and we've booked them all through 1CW. Him and Adam Ugly. But Adam Ugly and him,
So I got beef with them. They did attack me after that cage match in Felton. I got, you know, I never forgot that shit. You know what I mean? But anyway, congratulations to Ellsworth, man. Very proud of you, man. We all are here on the Eastern Shore and in the Delmarva Peninsula. We're proud of you, bro. Keep on doing the good work.
But the very first time I ever wrestled a match was yesterday, 4 years ago. That was the first time I had, that was my very first match, December 21st, and it was for Ecstasy.
Did you ever keep a log, man, of how many matches? When you first started, was you writing down, like, you had a little mail diary, like, I got this as mine, but you can't read it.
No, I never did any of that.
Well, you know, that's...
Because at that time, I was like, you know what, like,
Was you squashing cats when you first came in the league, or was you your team? Like, we all did. We took our falls for a little while.
Yeah, I came and took my falls.
Yeah, I took my fall to my ass. Oh, ass bro. Yeah. You know what I was doing? Way different than what he be doing. You know what I mean? He does exactly what the fuck I want him to do, but my dumb ass bumped my head walking around the court of the ECW Arena in 2001, and something said, do hardcore. And I was like, and I got stuck with it, but, you know, I really wanted to elevate myself as a good independent professional wrestler. I should have got into it when I was younger. You all know that. I'm 48 years old. That tells you how old I was in 2001 when I started, you know what I mean, fucking.
So when you coming back?
If any independent that wants to go ahead and put, not me, I'm done. Hellaware Assassin is done. He's retired. But he's got a friend. And he hasn't made his debut. He's looking right at him right now. It's ain't the time or the place to introduce this guy. You've seen him before. But I figure when I put him out there, they gonna start talking about him. You got to see what he looks like when he's rocking and rolling. But anyway, fuck him. Listen, you're doing your thing, man. You're going to blow the fuck up, bro. Stick with this radio. I know you're going to. I know it's in your heart. It's your passion. You love this business. Speaking of the business, who is the top worker so far in your 4.5-year career that you faced that was like, has a name, that has that legendary name? Anybody, like former WWE workers that you've ever been in the ring to work?
I've been in the ring with Val Venus.
Yeah, well, Val Venus, he's a smart man. Val Venus, yo, you know that cat, yo, bro. That dude was over. I love him. He was over, man. I love him, man.
I've been in the ring with Val Venus. I've been in there with Brodus Clay.
Big Brodus Clay?
Yeah.
I remember I talked to him on Facebook when I was about when we were trying to get him for that show before I left. Matter of fact, I left when Brodus came back in 2014 going,
and that's the year.
Yeah, that was the year I rolled out. California, man. You know what I'm going to But I'm saying, so, bang. So you got Brodus Clay. You're standing there. You're in the ring. What did you say? What did you say to him when you first met Brodus Clay?
To be honest with you, I didn't really have a conversation with him.
Right.
Because I didn't want to come across as like being a mark. You know what I'm saying? Like he's one of the boys just like I am. You know what I'm saying? I didn't want to come in. Oh well, hey brother, I watch
you fucking out.
I watch you on TV and all that.
No, not the time.
I didn't want to come in like, hey brother, I watch you on TV and all that. Like, that's not what I did.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, the way I was trained, the way I was taught, it's the same way they said in the locker room. You're just like them. Like they're not above you. You're not below them.
Right.
Like they sit in the same locker room as you.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm not gonna go out. Like I went up, shook his hand. Hey, how you doing, sir?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I did do that, like the respectful thing, but. Like, I'm not going to go in there and suck his dick, no homo. Like, that's not what I do. You know what I'm saying? Like, I look at it basically like, you're just like me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, I went into him, shook his hand, hey, we're doing business tonight.
Right.
And then walked off.
That's cool, yeah, because me and Sean saw him in Ocean City, Maryland, man. We went down to see the Briscoes were at ringside. It was me, Sean, it was Mark and Jay was down there, his family, some friends, they were with the kids.
Yeah.
And, oh my God, Big Eddie was there from, you know, Tag Team News, 400-something, New Day. But Eddie was there, oh man, Orton was there, you know, blew the place up.
Hey, listen. Orton is one of the coolest dudes I've ever met in wrestling.
Oh, that is.
Next to EC3.
Right, right.
those two are like the coolest dudes ever.
Yeah, Orton's cool, man. Me and Sean saw him down there. Look, everybody else is pulling up in their cars, their rentals. Man, this dude comes around the corner in a full-fledged tour bus. All in white. I can see him sitting, like, in the leather chair, you know, looking at the way the driver's driving it in. You know, his girl, she is, his wife is in the vehicle. It pulls up, you know, and he gets out, and you got all the trailers, you know, you got, at the time, I think Brian Danielson and CM Punk and all them were on the sides of the trailers.
Right.
And he pulls up, and he gets out, you know, and there's only, like, me and Sean and maybe 10 other, you know, fans standing there catching them as they come in. And me and Sean's like, yo, Randy, what's up, bro? And Sean was like, what's up, Viper? And he threw his hand all up and waved at us as he was pulling his bag. I said, that's cool that they acknowledge, you know, even not knowing that fucking we're in the business.
Right.
I had no idea. You know, they like we were backstage or anything. That came later. You know what I mean? But, yeah, now, I mean, especially when Mickie James was in, she was out, you know, we were doing things, you know, going places and seeing, you know, just having a great time. We've been there. I love this business. I mean, I know you love this business, and I know that what you got planned for this radio thing is going to take off, man. You know what I mean? I really think it's going to take off. You're strictly about the magazine each time it comes out? Are you going to have, like, episodes like what we're doing right here? You're going to have segment, like, you know, where you're going to have people on?
Yeah, man, I'm the focus.
There's some Baltimore professional wrestlers over there that are like, how many legends, how many people in the Maryland area or Baltimore that are... still alive, would be willing to come on your show, bro.
I mean, like, everybody that I've talked to has, like, reached out with open arms. Like, hey, dude, like, whatever you need from me, just
James Ellsworth. He's got to come on just out of pure respect for, like, you know. You know you met him once, you say?
I've met him more than once.
Like, but you only worked him once?
I want to work him once.
Yeah, he's good. Cool. I mean, it's like, I never worked him.
You know?
Never at all. I would have loved to, but I was always involved with the manager role or the backstage commentary or me and what's the dude now? Oh my God, I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry if you want. Brittenham. You know, Brittenham and I were like, you know, what we're doing right here.
Right.
This is what we did for OneCW. And, you know, to see him doing his thing with 302 Pro, you know, and your involvement. Yeah, speaking of, who's your family, man? Come on, who's your fam? I mean, they don't know. Who's he working for? You know, you didn't talk about that. We're past 32 minutes. Let's keep going.
Hey, look, we cool with him.
Well, this phone is funny. She could end any minute and say, hey, you got no memory on here. Yeah, then we'd have to start and do a little segment part two.
Hey, I don't mind me and Boo that. But as far as my family.
Right, like as far as, you know, who'd you call home? You know what I mean? As far as what federation you really like working for on the Eastern Shore?
I don't have one.
So you're looking to get somebody rise to the top.
I am a free agent.
Free agent right now. So let me ask you a question. Do you have a squad? Do you have an entourage of people? Do you have other wrestlers
that are rock and roll? Yeah, I got a team. A team full of wrestlers and every valets and everything else. There's where we go.
You ready to go?
Like at any moment,
you can book some orders.
At any moment, I can pick the phone up, and of course, call Muddy Waters.
You make that call in 2001. Yo, what's going on? No, there's no speakerphone on this. Okay, speakerphones weren't out yet.
At any time, I can pick up the phone and I can call the Rampage Pro Wrestling Heavyweight Champ, Muddy Waters.
Damn right. That's my boy, Muddy Waters. What's going on, man? Congratulations on winning that title last week.
At any time, I can pick up the phone and call the 302 heavyweight champ.
Not the 302 heavyweight pro, that would be my boy.
No, 302 pro champ is Kendrick Lamar. At any time, I can pick that phone up and call him up.
That's what I'm saying, my boy.
Yeah.
You got the wild-ass eyes, man. You got the dreads, man. He looks crazy, man. He spits blood out. He's scared sometimes, dude. Yo, I'm scared. I get choked up when I think about that dude. Honestly, that's a work. That's a shoot. That dude, when I see him, the very first time I saw him, I said, yo, Sean, who the fuck that jacket in the go? He was like, that's Kendrick, or something like that. And I was like, because he came in with them, with his eyes looking like that, man. I didn't see him get down and put nothing in. You know, he came in like that.
Right.
And his voice, and his hair, he motherfucking like the Terminator, man. No, he looked like the Predator. We used to say something. That's what me and Sean do. He looked like the Predator. He looks just like the Predator, don't he?
Yeah, like
scary.
At any time, I can call either one of them two up. At any time, I can get on the phone. Can you hear me?
You're good now.
All right. At any time, I can get on the phone and I can call the beautiful KK up and she's ready to go.
She ready to rock and roll.
Ready to rock.
KK, she gonna rock and roll. Yo, yo, this girl kicks some ass, man. Don't mess with her. She slay me down by your hair, beat you all up. She got your face all up. She crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, got her. Phone call away. Yo, girl. Pack your bags.
If you, and to be honest with you, if you need a referee,
hey,
I got them ones.
Got them ones? Yeah.
Straight up. Like, yo, look. Road trip.
Well, let me tell you something. I mean, you know, I always think ahead and I always try to plan my future out.
Right.
Doing what I should have been doing 20-something years ago at 48. Should have been doing this shit when I was 28, even earlier. But there's always a reason things happen, man. You know what I mean? I'm trying to put this big comedy show together, you know, not getting off track from the wrestling because it's all about wrestling here, but there's benefits from it. There's things that I want to do, you know, with the profits from that show, if you feel me.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I'm pretty sure you know what I'm talking about, and that's, you know, there's nothing wrong with giving birth to something new. There's nothing wrong with trying something that everybody's done, but hey, guess what? One of the originators is sitting right here. Right here. I ain't know him. I ain't know this dude back in 1999 or 2000 or 2001. I've been going to ECW shows since 1995. You know what I mean? Me and Dollar Work Mike, that's all we did was ride up to Philadelphia as soon as we found out that, you know, Cactus Jack and fucking Terry Funk, you know what I mean, and Don Morocco and all these cats were wrestling in Philadelphia, and Chris Jericho and Eddie Guerrero, man, we were there. We heard about these dudes. We already read them in the magazines. Upstarts, upstarts, upstarts. Had to go see them. And look what evolved from ECW. So it can happen. You have a good product. And this is what I always told Sean, you know, when we'd be chilling at the house or in the car, Sean, if we give them a good product, bro, they're going to come back to see another round, another episode of that good product. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, it's that cliffhanger. We got to leave them with that cliffhanger at the very end of the show. Even if it means, you know, there's an attack or a run, and at the very end, somebody gets their ass whipped, the lights go out, when the lights come back on, that crew of people are gone. Well, guess what's going to happen next month?
Right.
Cats are coming back. They won't see that crew's going to show up. Just like what the Shield did. It was beautiful. I mean, it's great. And it can happen anywhere. It doesn't matter if somebody's done it already. It's not how they did it. It's how you do it. It's what creative twist that you put to it. That's what it's all about. So, yeah, I mean, there's plans, man. You know what I mean? And I've always, you know, I've stayed real and I've stayed true to this business. You know what I mean? I love it, man. I enjoy what I did. You know, there's a lot of people out there, man, that hated on me because of the way that I got into the business. But I took my business sense and said to myself, I can make some money from doing this, booking Combat Zone for Rax Bar and Village for T-Rex. And I can also work with this company. And I can also get fucking paid doing this. You know what I mean? So,
you know, I actually got heat for doing CZW.
Yeah, but you're gonna get it because they hate on it.
No, that's what I'm saying. Like, I went and I did CZW Dojo Wars.
Did you work Rockets? Was you part of? Who's you work
with? No. When I did the Dojo Wars, it was like,
where was that? Sewell, New Jersey.
Yeah, I just did it like, Blackwood.
Blackwood, New Jersey. So they didn't do it at Champs Arena or even the Fire Skate Zone.
They did it at their school.
At their place, all right. So it was a small little thing. And
every Wednesday night, they have Dojo Wars.
Dojo Wars. Check out their talents.
Yeah, and basically what it is.
You guys,
and basically what Dojo Wars is a feeder system. Like, they bring in guys.
I'll give it back to her.
They bring in guys from all over the world.
You ready?
I don't know what you did with it.
It's up here somewhere.
But they bring in guys from all over the world.
It's up here somewhere. I just can't
and
see it.
And when they bring them in, it's basically a talent evaluator. The way how they do it is they put you in the ring and you wrestle for whoever.
Right, right.
Each week, you're going
to... So they send Danny Havoc out. Fuck that. I was like, oh, wait a minute, yo. don't send him out here.
Like, so we went out and we
lost a lighter.
Yeah, I thought just put it up right now, right?
No, I tossed it back over there to them, but I thought I had one over here.
But it's all right, fuck that lighter.
But so when I went there, like, I didn't go, like, I used to train over here at the little school that for 302.
I used to
train for that. I used to train with
him. Okay, behind that, thought exchange.
Yeah, yeah.
In that shed.
Yeah, he used to train with him.
It's like a shed, but it's big. I'm not saying it's a shed, but it's like a big, gigantic shed, but it's perfect for just getting
and
training.
And they got mad with me because I didn't go to training because I did the CZW. Yeah. And I'm like, yo, do you not see what's going on? Like,
who I'm working with?
Dean Ambrose is a former CZW heavyweight champ, and he's now a former WWE champ. Rick Swann, former CZW worker. It's countless dudes like Cesaro.
Countless, man. I was in the locker room with him.
Like Kevin Owens. All these dudes that's been to CZW has went on to WWE. And I'm like,
Bo Dallas with him.
And it's like, yo, with the exposure that they can give me. Like me just going in and saying, and me telling them, hey, look, first thing they ask you when you come in, what's your name? Where are you from? Who trained you? I'm going in telling them, Marcus Waters, we coming from out of Delaware.
Right.
And we train at Spine Busters Wrestling Academy.
Spine Busters, is that what they're saying?
Yeah, they weren't like, okay, Spine Busters.
All right, okay, so who's a trainer?
So we're gonna put you in with these two guys.
Good trainer.
So they put us in with these two guys. We worked the opening match. Right? It was me and Franco Varga. We went in, we wrestled the first match, did our thing, and we got called back week after week after week. And it's like,
yeah, they had plans for you, and they're calling you back.
And
so they snatched that.
They get pissed off over here.
I gotta hit you. Where's the stick? Where's the stick at? Do I need to pop you in the head and shit? Because you're still sitting. You can be like the combat zone.
To be honest with you, that door
will be here soon.
That door hasn't closed yet. Like it's still an option. But this is the one thing that I will say, and every now and then when me and Franco talk, I always bring this up to him. I say, yo, dude, do you realize that everybody that was in the locker room with us, everybody that's in the locker room with us when we did the Dojo Wars, is now on CZW's main roster.
Main roster.
So.
And a couple of them are on their way. Matter of fact.
Right.
A lot of them's going too. He was part of that cruiserweight thing. He was the only combat zone wrestler that did make it.
Drew Gulak.
He's on the WWE now. He's on what? Right. Cruiserweight's coming out with the cruiserweight.
He's on the WWE.
He's out there.
And he. Let's
James Ellsworth.
And he has. Drew Gulak has a brother.
He's two fucking hands, baby.
Drew Gulak has a brother.
Roy Gulak. Little Mondo. Now, let me tell you about him. I remember Little Mondo back in 2001, when he was just a little tiny 12-year-old. Or 11, 12-year-old. He was all done up like Mondo. This shit, it was cool. He was I love that kid. Now he's like, he can guess.
Hey, he's hardcore, very technical.
He's technical and he's hardcore.
Yes.
He can nutty and he can kick your ass like some Kurt Angle.
Yes.
He can flip, slip, duper dip. He can do whatever he can do all that shit.
Whatever you want, that's how he's going to give it to you.
Wow. Yo, Marcus, we've been rocking for 45, man. That's good. I'm glad you're here. This is the longest episode of the JD The Good Show that I've had, but it's a good wrestling segment. And you put somebody next to me that knows about wrestling, I know about wrestling. You know, but we'll take it to 1 full hour. We're going another 15 minutes. Let me ask you a couple more questions here.
Sure.
Muddy Waters. can we get him here? Do you think we can? Could you get money here? Can we have the fucking champ here with the title straight in front so we can do an interview and put it out there? Sure. We got to get Muddy Waters here on the JD The Good Show featuring Marcus Waters. Muddy Waters.
Actually, right now, man, just so you see that, like a bullshit.
Yeah, don't fuck with it.
I don't have no service.
Oh, go on Wi-Fi when you need to get on. Don't give it, man. You get on the Wi-Fi. You want no service for phone calls down here.
Right.
You'd have to use the landline. You got to use this 1965 RCA phone. It's really nice. It's no speakerphone, nothing like that. So we're not going to hear your conversation unless I stick the phone like this. Put a TV, we can hear that, man. Anyway, so, all right. So, we could go to Marcus Waters, sir. That would be great. Listen, tell the champ. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to pay him a little money if I can get him. I know he's going to call some cash. It's Muddy Waters, man. Come on, man.
Muddy Waters.
Muddy Waters. Just, yo, it's Muddy Waters. That's all I'm going to say. But yeah, he's got to get this. Make sure you forward this over to him.
I got you.
Tell him to watch the last 15 minutes because we're going to talk about some Muddy Waters. When did you first meet this man? How long have you known him? I'm going to tell you, I've known him for a long, long time. I've known him since he was a teenager. You know what I mean? Because I've known my boy for a long time. Anyway, so yeah, when I first saw him wrestling, I was like, yeah, somebody else is doing it from right around the Cincinnati area. You know what I mean? Or just over high. Somebody from around here. Anyway, so you met him.
So I'm like we hit it off, like right away.
When? What year? 2003, 4, 5.
Damn,
10 would be 6 years. Was it 2010? 6-7 years ago? Did you meet him through the business?
No, because
you're from where? You're one of the Maryland boys.
Yeah, I went to a DCW show.
Right.
And they had the show out in Smyrna, Delaware, which is his, it was his very first show.
Right.
And I seen him and I was like, oh, okay, cool. Because before I even decided that, I'm going to get into the business,
right.
Like, I used to go to the shows and be like, oh, man, the shit they doing, I can do that.
Right.
I'm better. I ain't
that shit. That's what I was saying when I'm from South
Africa. I'm like, man, that, the way they just did that. I can do that. I'm like,
my ass kicked, Marcus.
I'm like, man, I know.
I got my ass kicked for a long time.
I'm like, man, I know I'm better than that.
Yeah.
What they're doing.
It's yo.
So
it wasn't a chicken coop. Wasn't like the one I had. I'll tell you about that later.
So I seen him, right? So I seen him, and that day I watched the show, went back home, seen one of my cousins, and when I talked to my cousin, he I was like, yo, cuz, I know what we should start doing.
Right.
He was like, what's that? I said, man, we should start wrestling.
Wrestling.
So
your brother said, oh man, what?
So when
he put the F word out there. I ain't doing that F shit.
No, he didn't do that. He was like, yo, you know something was crazy? I got a friend of mine that just started doing it.
Right. Speaking of him.
And I'm like, what's your friend's name? He was like, man, Muddy Waters. I said, yo, get the fuck out of here, bro. I said, yo, get the fuck out of here. I just seen this dude yesterday. That's your boy?
You know how he got the name, right?
Yeah.
I was with him. He was little. We was chilling. He was little. We was over at his Aunt Judy's house, right? He was sitting outside in a puddle of muddy water. Right? And the aunt said, yo, what the hell is he doing in the muddy water? And then they started calling him Muddy Water. That's a joke. They didn't do that. That's a good one, though, right? Because he's been in muddy water. He's sitting in muddy water. Anyway, I'm sorry. Don't punch me in the eye, champ. Don't give me too much.
So we fuck around and
Let the world hear you, buddy.
So we fuck around and my cousin hit him up on Facebook and said, hey, listen, I got a cousin of mine speaking to me that wants to get into the business.
Right.
And he wanted to know, like, where did you train at, whatever. So we exchanged information. I got up with him and I told him, like, hey, just shoot me an address. I'm coming out. And like, there's so many people that tell you, like, hey, I want to be in the business, and I'm going to come in, I'm going to do this and that, whatever. And they never show up, or they don't last.
Right.
So I showed up the first night. He was like, okay, so this motherfucker's about what he's saying. Let's see how long you stick around.
Right.
And then it'd be days that I would be beating him. Like, we train at Harvest.
Mark Harvest Gym.
Mark Harvest Gym.
Right. That's the one that was over there in Camden, right? Yeah. One time back in the storage. Yeah. That's a dope ass spot.
Yeah, right.
The ring, man. You can do a little show. You can do a little show.
That's where I saw him.
That's where I first saw you, too. I mean, the show over there. We were sitting out the ring in the third row. It was only four rows off to the right.
Yeah.
That was a small fucking place. Man, it was hot as Africa in that motherfucker. You know how hot it was in there? Door open, still hot as shit in that motherfucker. Yeah. They close the door, that damn fans going.
Imagine being in the ring.
Ooh. Oh, I've done it. 4th of July, Suburban, ECW, outside, hot as shit, canvas hot.
Yeah, so you met him, you got his vibe as soon as you met him.
Yeah, as soon as I met him, let's do some vibe.
He talked you into it, didn't he?
No, I was already ready to go.
Well, he's right, already trained.
As soon as I seen the ring, I'm like, yo, let's do it.
Let's do this.
And then that's when it was just like,
I'm excited right now. I was excited. First time I knew I was going to get in there and do something.
I really was. And to be honest with you, I
had a shitload of fans come see me.
When the shit, I mean,
6%. But it's good. It was early in my career. It was it. So anyway.
But like my, well, the first thing when I first seen him with the outdoor show in Smyrna, which was his first match, I said to myself, and I said it to my girlfriend at the time, I was like, yo, look, me and this motherfucker right here, we're going in this bitch and winning tag team champions. We're winning tag champs.
You guys are going to vibe if you put together a tag team.
And a year and a half later,
champs.
We were champs. You know what I'm saying? A year and a half later, we're the champs.
Right on.
Two
champions sitting right here in front of you. He's held gold, I've held gold.
Then you had like 3 years later. When you come through the state of Delaware.
You held titles for 3 years.
Nah, we ain't hold that long, but
you said we ain't hold that long.
Like a month. No, I was way longer than that.
Right.
What I'm saying is
5 months, 10 months, a year, less than a year, 6 months, 1 8
yeah,
months.
Two times.
You 2 times champ?
Yeah.
Oh man. See, but more bets than I did, man.
But basically, what happened?
Show's over.
Basically, what happened, right? You had, when we first came in, you had the Briscoes and you had D-Line.
Right.
Those are the two tag teams. Those are the two tag teams that everybody looked up and respected.
Yeah. For this area.
The best.
Maryland and Delaware. Briscoe's D-Line. I agree with you.
When the Hotlanta Hustlers came along.
That was you, boy. The Hotlanta Hustlers in the house.
When the Hotlanta Hustlers came along.
That's right. That's cool.
Like, everybody would be like, oh man, the Briscoes and this and that and that. Whatever. Listen, if you want to get to them.
You got to get to us.
If you want to get to the Briscoes, you got to go through the Hotlanta Hustlers. Like, that's basically how we carried that whole thing. If you want to get to the Briscoes, you got to go through the gatekeeper, which was the Hotlanta Hustlers.
Yeah, we get the water on. It's all good. Damn, that thing scares me.
But that's the way how we carry that whole situation. Like, if you want to get to the Briscoes.
Oh, now you want to drink.
It's for him.
Okay.
I've already been sucking on this one. It's almost water.
I brought it for him.
Yeah, if you want to get to the Briscoes, you got to go through us.
Oh, I am here nice. I'm thinking I'm hallucinating back here here nice.
And that's
hallucinating. That is nice ice cubes you're hearing.
And that's the way we carry that whole
You guys got the titles.
Yeah.
Not once, but twice you guys won it. Now, who did you beat to get them for the first time? I got to hear this.
We beat Crazy Shay.
Oh!
And
that crazy white boy is crazy.
We beat Crazy Shay and Kendrick.
Oh, yeah, but Kendrick, who did you do? Tell me Crazy Shay got pinned and not Kendrick.
Yeah, we beat. Kendrick left Shay. Beat him up, left him in the cage. Like, who won in the cage?
Ooh! And he covered.
Yeah, and we whooped his ass.
And
he
covered.
Yeah,
it's covered.
Is
he Jewish?
Yeah.
Hot damn, yeah, my Jewish. Boy! Did you get down? Did you get down like me?
No, he did.
Well, did he get down like
me? Yeah, we beat him down.
Some deep ones up there, ain't it? Have you ever noticed that?
Yeah.
That's nasty motherfuckers. Yo, that's dangerous shit though, that ain't. Don't matter. Yo, that shit's crazy, bro. Let me tell you something, man. I don't give a fuck. You ain't got to juice it all. That shit. Get your head thrown into one of them cages. Got them little knots, little steel, little pieces of metal that don't, you know what I mean? Let that bad boy tear you up. Let the motherfucker rake your head back and forth across that shit. You're gonna grab some skin, buddy. You're going to get hurt. So, when you got in that cage, was that your first cage match?
Yeah.
Is that the only one you've done so far?
No, I've done two.
Dang, you lucky bastard, you got me twice. No, you don't. I did a cage match with Axel Rotten, and then I was in Cage of Death 10 for Combat Zone Wrestling. In and out quicker than what you could blink an eye, take one pop of popcorn, throw it in your mouth, and take one swing out the straw. I was pretty much done. But hey,
We won the belts in the cage.
Fucking right.
And we lost them in the cage. We lost the belts.
How good was the match?
We lost the belts to Adam Flash and Rock and Rebel.
Well, you couldn't have lost them to a better tag team. Real good. Both of them legends. One been in the league for 20-something plus years, over 25 probably. The other one's a good 22, right behind them.
Right.
So, that's Adam Flash. You know, Rock and Rebel, I've been seeing Rock and Rebel since he was in ECW. He had a long mullet, curly hair. It was all pretty cool shit. That was my boy. Known him for a long time. But, so, you guys have, we got 5 minutes to go. So you guys have won. You're 2-time tag team champs.
Yep.
Both in steel cage matches.
Yep.
Pretty brutal. Blood everywhere. You guys kicked each other's ass. You right. You didn't. No cheating. No nothing. You just boom. 1, 2, 3. Legally put them down. They got the win. I'm sitting here with the 2-time champion, and his boy be here soon. And he's got some gold now. And there's a good possibility that in the future, you guys will be hearing some news about something new going to happen here soon. You know what I mean? We get something rock and rolling. If anybody can get a rock and rolling, we can, because, you know, we know people. I mean, we know this business. I know this business. I know what Patas is in the seats. And I just got done rapping to my partner in crime just like 2 days ago. I mean, I think it was yesterday afternoon, so don't fuck with us. You know what I'm saying? Because we can get some pretty, you know, we can get some pretty nasty boys working for us. I mean, it's, what? Delaware's back in Delaware, and, oh, and he's teamed up. He's talking. Marcus is hanging. Oh, shit. Oh, Marty Waters, too? Oh, shit. The boy's going, oh, that's like a, that's like black pepper, and white salt. That's like an Oreo cookie championship tag team. That's like a 3-man, that's a 6-man tag. Man, we the shit. Anyway, but look, you never know what can happen. You know what I mean? Future news. But so you guys talk. You talk to him every now and then. I did ask you to try to get a hold of my host if you're trying to get on no service down here. Hit him up when you leave.
I talk to him basically like every day.
Hey, he was friends with me on Facebook, and I always comment on some of his stuff, but I don't think I got my follow turned on him. I need to turn it on. Or he don't put up nothing much. He is awful quiet. Why is the champ so quiet? He's not hyped up at all. I'm telling you, this dude is mellow.
He's not like me.
He ain't like me.
I'm live all the time.
Wow. I wake up like this. I do, and so is my boy back there on the couch. He wakes up and he's like, are we going live? Yes. Yes. Or when can we go ahead and film a couple episodes? I like doing that. I can film, I'll do 4. You know, 4 is 2 hours. And we're working on 2 more minutes and we get ready to be bye-bye. You know what I mean? Until you check out episode number 2 of this, which we'll probably shoot at a later date. But you got a full hour of meeting this guy right here. And Muddy Waters is going to be coming here real soon. You know what I mean? Like, real soon. And the next time that you do get to view this, we will let everybody know prior, you know, to it, because he'll be live.
Gotcha.
I mean, so we'll get him on the feed down here. He'll be live. You guys can tune in and check him out. You can subscribe to my YouTube channel. We're going to get one started for this man right here. And you can subscribe to his, and let's take it to another level. Let's give it 5. You know, that's what Bassmaster said. Give it 5 years. And you'll reach 1 million views on something. He said, just rock and roll with it. So, Marcus, thank you very much, man, for coming out here tonight. You know, I'm just going
hey,
to...
Hey, can I, before we wrap,
I just want to
say this one thing.
Get it up here. It's just a microphone.
All right, this is the one thing that I want to put up. I spoke on it last night on my live feed.
Right.
But I wanted to... And your followers will catch it too.
Right.
Anybody that you see me with, like, I fuck with them hard. No homo. Like, that, like, that's right here, that's my partner. You know what I'm saying? I wouldn't be here with him right now if it wasn't like that. There's a lot of other people.
True friends.
There's a lot of other people that you may see me with. KK, Marlon, Muddy, Kendrick, whoever.
Muddy and Kendrick.
If you see me with these people,
they might all be here soon.
bust their ass doing what they do, man.
Like shit go.
Respect them.
And this is not even, this is actually a shoot. Shit go from 0 to 1,000 real fucking quick.
Real quick.
Especially with me. So if you see, like I said, if you see me with whoever.
Respect.
Show them the same respect that you want to show me.
I mean, do that, man. Listen, that's it. It goes a long way. I mean, I've told a lot of people, too, man. I've had a lot of people, you know what I mean, that come at me with that negative bullshit. Save it. Got no time for it, man. We're not about all that. We grown-ass men here. If you can't work together, then you just stay away from each other. You know what I mean? You can be friends. You just might not be good business partners to work with each other. It takes a special kind of person to do what he does and what I do. And what I did and what he's doing now, what he will be doing this here in the future, we'll be doing all this. If that made any fucking sense. But anyway, thank you very much, man. It's a good point that you just got across. It's very positive. I can feel the positive aura around you, Marcus Waters. I mean, so we look forward to having Muddy Waters here on the show. And, hey, man, I don't want to turn around one of these days and see that vampire hanging behind me. I got a funny feeling you're going to pull some crazy shit. But that's okay. He's more than welcome to come here, too. I want all the champs. I want all the title holders to come here. Because this is the show on Delmarva and the Maryland Peninsula, the Maryland Eastern Shore, everything. We're just going to try to spread it out there. I've already got viewers on the West Coast of Los Angeles, Seattle, Maine, and Florida, and Texas, and in Chicago. I got my viewers, and they share every time I'm live. And now we're starting to put these out. You know, I'm averaging one viewer per hour on one of our videos we shot yesterday. We're at, like, 30 or 40 viewers right now just from yesterday. So that's cool, because normally it would sit at 5 and 10 for a while. You know what I mean? But now it's starting to jump. We want it to jump slowly. It's like a slow clock. Click. Click. Before you know it, it's going to click. Click. Because people are viewing. So spread it. You know, share this video with all your friends, man. Put it on your Facebook wall. And Marcus, I appreciate you coming out, man. Thank you very, very much. I want you to come to the show. You know what I mean? At this comedy event, might need you to work some security. We might need it in the house that night. You know what I mean?
Right, so, that's
the 28th of January. Hopefully it's at the...
I'll be in West Virginia.
Okay, you'll be in West Virginia. Well, maybe Muddy Waters might be around if he's not kicking ass with you in steel cages and shit.
Actually, the 28th.
Yeah, let them know you're going to be here recently. Like, if you, well, you're rolling out. But so far, nothing in the Delaware, Maryland.
I'm not going to say nothing, because you never know.
Okay, you think something right here.
No.
It's not even kayfabe.
I mean, it's just, like, you never know.
You never know.
I mean, like, me and some people.
Don't want to give it out. If we do know right now, it's not cool to let it
be. Me and some people, we may squash some differences or whatever.
Yeah.
Pop up.
It's going to happen.
If not.
So it's all about, there's business, and then there's, all right, man, I'll see you next month.
Right.
You know what I mean? Here's your money. Here's my money. Bye-bye. And we might not talk on the phone, but come day to make the money, we all do our parts. But that's not the circle we want. You know, we want that tight bond circle. You know what I mean? Real close, all business, good friends, good workers, good crowd, good food. Bang. That's what we're all about, man. And again, I appreciate you coming here, man. And this has been JD Degood on the JD Degood Show. In the background, we got Zepocious back chilling and relaxing. Denise, the MC. She'll say goodbye in her sleeps. And this is Marcus. And I'm JD, man. I'm going to reach across the camera right here, and I'm going to turn this off because we're gone. So enjoy the show. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.